Hello and welcome to episode 17 of Chemistry in 15 Minutes or Less. My name is Audra and this review lesson is on chapter 22, part 1, Organic Compounds and Reactions. Now, most carbon-containing compounds are organic. There are a couple of things that aren't, like pure carbon, either graphite, diamond, or other combinations like cyanides, etc. Now, carbon is essential to life for three main reasons. The first reason is that carbon-to-carbon bonds are very strong. It also has a low reactivity. And it forms four bonds. Now, as far as organic compounds are concerned, there are tens of thousands of them that we know of, because organic compounds are basically just long chains of carbons that can grow infinitely long and have infinite numbers of side groups with infinite numbers of carbons in those chains as well. Now, there are a couple of different ways to write formulas for these that we've been using in class. We use the molecular formula. There is a condensed version of this, which is slightly less important. Structural formula, which is super, super important. We use this one all the time. There is also a condensed version of this one as well, which we don't really use. Skeletal structure, which is also pretty important. And then the space filling model. I'm just going to go ahead and write out formula because I did for the rest. Now, molecular formula is what you'll be familiar with. For example, we'll use C4H10. Now, to write that as a condensed formula, you would write it as CH3, CH2, parentheses, 2, CH3. That'll make more sense when you see the structural formula, which this one is hyper important, where you have your parent chain of carbons, which in this case is 4, and then all 10 hydrogens drawn out and their bonds. Now you can see this because there's a CH3 bonded to two CHs bonded to a CH3. Now, the condensed formula here, the condensed structural formula, you write similar to the condensed molecular formula, but with slightly more information. The skeletal structure is kind of strange, but basically you use lines, and every time the line either ends or bends, that is to show a carbon in the chain. So for example, for this one we would have four carbons where there's a carbon here, 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 here. Now you don't actually have to write C's in, that's just for the purposes of me drawing the model. In the space filling model, we don't use that, but basically that would be draw out circles for the carbons and then individual little circles for the hydrogens that follow it. Now, as you can see, going down we gain more and more information, minus the condensed, the further down we go. Now, one very, very key thing to all of this is that there is free rotation in a carbon-carbon single bond. This is what allows it to form different types of isomers, but it also prevents it from forming some types. Now, I mentioned isomers. An isomer is basically atoms that are bonded in different ways. There are the same number of atoms, the same elements present, those kinds of things, but they are still different. The main ones that we need to worry about are structural isomer and a geometric isomer. Now, a structural isomer is basically where the structure, or in this case the order, changes. But there's still the same number of things. So for example, if you had a 5-carbon chain, but this time you have 4 and the carbon is here, because you can't bend this chain to become this one, which is what makes it an isomer. I'm not going to saturate it with hydrogens, that's a little too much work. And for a geometric isomer, the order is the same, but the arrangement in space is different. Now, in order for this to occur, you have to have a multi-bond of at least a double bond, because that hinders the rotation of the carbon atoms, which is why there is free rotation in single, hindered rotation in multi, or in this case, we'll probably talk about a double one. Now, to do an example of this, because you also have to worry about naming for these, let's look at chlorine bonded to carbon, double bonded to carbon, bonded to chlorine, and then there's hydrogen. Now, there are three different ways to draw this through isomers. You can also have it where you have hydrogen to chlorine to a hydrogen, double bonded to a carbon, bonded to a chlorine, bonded to a chlorine. Now, these top two ways that I drew it, are what are called cis isomers. Now, cis in this case means this side, or the same side. As you can see, the two hydrogens are up top, or the two hydrogens are next to each other, same with the chlorines. The other type would be trans, which is where you would have it look something like this. Now, like I said, this would be called trans, which in this case means cross, because pretty much as you can see here, the chlorine and the hydrogen are both on opposite sides, but are close to each other, and on this side the hydrogens are together, chlorines are together, but in this one there is a different arrangement, the hydrogens on the bottom on one side and the top on the other. Now there is another type of isomer, it is referred to as stereo or an optical isomer, but we didn't really cover those in class. All those mean is that it rotates light in different directions and the order is different, but we didn't have any examples and I couldn't find anything else about it in my notes. So. And another thing to talk about with organics is that properties depend on molecular size, if there's branching or ring structures, and the functional groups, which is what we'll talk about in another lesson. We did talk about organic reactions at the end of this chapter, but I lumped them in here because we had space and, more importantly, time. Now, there are four main types of organic reactions. A substitution reaction, an addition reaction, condensation reaction, and an elimination reaction. Now I'm going to quickly start two of these that are important for polymerization, addition, and condensation. We'll get back to that after I go over the types of reactions. Now, a substitution reaction is a reaction in which one or more atoms replace another atom or group of atoms in a molecule. Which, basically, for lack of a better example, if we had, let's say, methane here, we would replace this with a chlorine from chloromethane. Oop, that should be C. And then this would become a hydrogen. I'm just going to go ahead and we'll go on to addition reaction, which is a reaction in which two parts of a molecule are added to an unsaturated molecule, increasing the saturation. Now, we haven't talked about saturation much yet, but basically, if we have this molecule and it has six hydrogens, it's full of hydrogens, this would be saturated. But if we had instead double bond in the middle, this can no longer have as many hydrogens as possible for as many bonds as there are. This type of reaction breaks the bond and then saturates it. So if you had a chain here, with a double bond here, a free radical, which is basically, for example, this, any sort of molecule that has an open bond, it comes in and it breaks that bond so that way it can fill up or attach to another molecule, which is why it's important in polymerization. Like I said, we'd get back to that. A condensation reaction is a reaction in which two molecules or parts of the same molecule combine. But in the process of this, a small molecule is removed, and this requires at least two functional groups to occur. Now, a type of condensation reaction you might remember from bio is something called dehydration synthesis, which is where two molecules form and water is lost in the process of putting them together. And the final reaction, which is an elimination reaction, which is a reaction in which a simple molecule, such as water or ammonia, is formed from adjacent carbon atoms of a larger molecule. This just means, when there is a big molecule, it then forms water or ammonia to get rid of it and make the atom or molecule smaller. Now, I know that's a little confusing, and this isn't when we talked about it in class, but the last thing to talk about is polymerization. Now, polymerization is basically the forming of a polymer. A polymer, for a definition, is a large molecule made of many small units joined to each other through organic reactions. Now, the small molecules are called monomers, and the big molecules are called polymers. That's what makes them different. But basically, a monomer plus a monomer gives you a dimer. A dimer plus a monomer is a trimer, but then, after dimer and trimer, you tend to call them polymers. Now, polymerization can only be done through either an addition or a condensation reaction, and it goes through three steps. The first step is called initiation, which is where you use a free radical, like, say, in this case, we'll just go with, we'll draw hydrogen, for lack of a better example, that can go in and break a double bond or create the chain. You have the second step, which is called chain propagation, which is just the continued use of, basically, when you break the bond, you then create a free radical on the first monomer. That's not the free radical, which can then attach to more by breaking another bond and creating another free radical, which is how the chain continues and continues to grow. And then, the last step, termination, which obviously is the end of the polymerization reaction, where it stops and the molecule is formed without any free radicals left. I'm not going to draw an example. We didn't spend a whole lot of time on this. We did a lab on it, but there was no lab report with that, so it's not quite as important. And with that, we should conclude episode 17 of Chemistry in 15 minutes or less. Feel free to leave questions or suggestions in the comments below, and be sure to follow the in-video links, check out the playlist, or head over to my channel for more videos on chemistry review. And as always, I hope this helps, and have a great day.